Guns, Germs, and Steel by Jared Diamond. Part 2. The Rise and Spread of Food Production. Summary. In Part 2, Diamond asks, what gave the Spanish such an advantage over the Incas? Spanish technology allowed Pizarro to defeat Atahualpa. This technology would have been impossible without agricultural advancements that began almost 1,000 years before that event. Agriculture and controlled farming were more efficient than hunting and gathering, so there was time for specialization to develop. Farming allowed social stratification to develop, with many peasants working for a small group that owned land. These owners were then freed up to develop new technologies and skills because they didn't have to spend all their time hunting for food. Populations grew as more people could be fed. While societies developed agriculture, they also began to domesticate certain large animals. These societies had the technology, energy, and time to go to war against other nations. They were also the first to catch infectious diseases like smallpox, measles, and the flu from these animals, which allowed them to develop resistance to these diseases. Basically, agriculture and domestication led to dense populations and societies that were settled, politically centralized, technologically innovative, and economically complex. Ironically, however, the areas of the world that had the best climate for agriculture were not the ones to invent agriculture. Mesopotamia was among the first places where agriculture could be found, even though it was a dry environment. In North America and Australia, agriculture appeared when foreign invaders came and was probably introduced through a single plant that was farmed. In this way, agriculture spread from its origins in Mesopotamia through to most other parts of the world. It is more difficult to explain why food production did not appear until modern times in some areas that should have been very suitable for it, such as the west coast of the United States. On the other hand, it did appear in some areas that seemed infertile. Only a few areas of the world were able to develop food production independently at very different points in time. Those people who had a head start on food production also had a head start on developing guns, germs, and steel. This distinction between areas that developed early food production and areas where people remained hunter-gatherers separated the haves and the have-nots. All societies began as hunter-gatherer, so the difference between human societies did not exist from the beginning. Being a farmer was not always better than being a hunter-gatherer. Some farmers spend more hours per day on food production than hunter or gatherers do. In some places, people were exposed to farming but decided not to adopt it. Also, some people became sedentary without adopting food production. Being sedentary and producing food were not necessarily linked. It is also important to understand that food production was not discovered or invented. Instead, it came to be as a result of decisions that were made without full knowledge of their consequences. In studying the rise of food production, Diamond considers why it evolved in some places at certain times rather than in others. In fact, people began by both collecting and cultivating wild foods. They increased cultivation and decreased collection only after it became obvious that their available crops proved to be especially good for cultivation. The availability of such crops varied by region. Five major factors contributed to the relative advantage of cultivation in certain areas: declining availability of wild foods, increased availability of domesticatable wild plants, the development of technologies that made food production easier, rising population density, and the increased military strength of food producers as compared to hunter-gatherers. Hunter-gatherers were able to resist the pressure to become food producers only in areas that were isolated and made the immigration of food producers or techniques very difficult. In most other areas, food production became the best strategy. Why were certain wild plants good for crops while others weren't? Part of the reason is the features of certain plants. Some plants were obvious choices for hunter-gatherers. The best ones were large in size, tasty, had seedless fruits, and long fibers. Hunter-gatherers generally harvested wild plants that had these desirable qualities. They unconsciously dispersed these favorable plants more than others. These plants slowly became more common until they became domestic crops. These more useful plants were also affected by non-human factors: seeds being dispersed more easily, some seeds being saved for later so that a drought would not kill all plants at one time, and self-reproduction that allowed beneficial mutations to spread more easily. Overall, both human and natural selection helped certain plants to survive and spread more than others. Natural selection refers to the process of species evolving through random mutations that allow them to survive and reproduce successfully. These better adapted plants were the ones that later became crops. Some of these plants included barley, peas, and cereals that grew in the Fertile Crescent. The production of cereal, in particular, gave the Fertile Crescent a huge advantage because such crops grew fast, were high in carbohydrates, and produced a lot of edible food per area cultivated. They gave people in the Fertile Crescent a huge advantage by providing them with more plentiful and efficient food options. Areas that grew things like acorns had a disadvantage. Acorns, for example, are a very inefficient food source. Oak trees take an extremely long time to grow. Their seeds are spread by squirrels in a way that makes them impossible for humans to select and control. And they are much more bitter than other nuts like almonds. Therefore, local environments had a huge impact on the rate of the development of food production. Areas that had wild crops that were easier and more efficient to domesticate were the first to develop food production. Why did agriculture not develop independently in areas that seemed fertile and suitable for these kinds of crops? The explanation could be with local people being incompetent, but Diamond argues that it was a problem with the locally available wild plants. There are very few major crops in the world, and humans have not domesticated any new major crops in thousands of years. It is therefore not surprising that many areas of the world don't have a naturally occurring major crop, and that local peoples would not be able to domesticate the less favorable ones they did have. However, it is harder to explain why certain plants were domesticated in one area and not in another. To answer the question, you need to understand the general environmental context of the areas where plants failed to be domesticated. it is important to remember that plant domestication always had to compete with the hunter-gatherer lifestyle for convenience. If domestication was not significantly more efficient, then people would not adopt it. In areas that didn't domesticate major crops, there were not enough other domesticatable wild plants to justify the effort needed to domesticate the ones that were domesticated in other areas. For example, nomadic hunter-gatherers would not give up their traditional lifestyle to care for apple orchards unless there were other plant and animal options that would make this sedentary existence more attractive than the hunter-gathering lifestyle. For agriculture to develop, an area had to have a lot of easily domesticated major crops and animals. The combination of wild plants and animal species available is important to keep in mind when determining why a certain group of people succeeded or failed to domesticate a particular plant. The Fertile Crescent had five important advantages compared to other areas. First, it had the world's largest Mediterranean temperate climate zone, which meant that it had a high diversity of wild plant and animal species, and therefore many different options for domestication. Second, it had the greatest seasonal climatic variation, which was good for the evolution of many annual plants and helped increase the diversity of the region. Third, it had a wide range of altitudes in a short distance, which allowed people to have many harvest seasons. After harvesting the first group of crops in a low area, they could move higher to harvest seeds as they continued to mature. Fourth, it had many big wild mammals that could be domesticated. Mammals such as sheep, goats, and cows could help with the farming of plants as well. Fifth, it had less competition from the hunter-gatherer lifestyle because there were not many options for fishing or hunting animals for meat. All of these advantages were included in the natural environment of the Fertile Crescent and not with the biology or culture of its people. People in the Fertile Crescent domesticated local plants much earlier because of these many environmental advantages. They then domesticated more productive and valuable species, developed a denser human population more rapidly, and entered the modern world with more advanced technology, complex political organization, and epidemic diseases that would infect other populations. Success also means avoiding many separate possible causes of failure. If just one necessary factor for success in domestication is missing, then domestication will fail overall. The availability of potentially domesticatable wild animals was also an important feature of an environment. Domestication of animals means changing them into something more useful to humans. Not many species are actually suitable for domestication, and most efforts to domesticate animals have resulted in failure. There are six factors that contribute to successful domestication of a species. If it doesn't have a special diet, if it grows quickly, if it breeds well in captivity, if it has a pleasant disposition, if it does not tend to panic under pressure, and if it has a social structure that allows it to accept humans as new pack leaders. This explains why horses are domesticatable, but zebras are not. Horses travel in herds and are calmer. Zebras tend to be rebellious even when in captivity. Domestication of animals is actually very difficult, since the animal must meet all six conditions. Eurasian peoples inhabited an area that naturally had more wild animals that were good for domestication. This was because Eurasia had a large area with ecological diversity that gave it many species. Many species did not go extinct there, so there were more surviving animals suitable for domestication compared to other continents. One of the most obvious and important environmental differences across continents is axis orientation. The Americas span a larger distance from north-south than east-west, but Eurasia's main axis is east-west. This means that, in Eurasia, the climate is relatively similar across all areas of the continent. Places with the same latitude have the same day length, seasonal variation, diseases, temperatures, and habitats. In the Americas, on the other hand, climate varies drastically from the north to the south. It was much easier for crops and livestock to spread on continents where the climate was similar overall. This is because the food and livestock first domesticated in the Fertile Crescent were already well adapted to the climate in other parts of Eurasia and could quickly spread across the continent. Because food production contributed to denser populations and more potential for complex societies and technologies, this had an effect on the development of writing, technology, and empire as well. Eurasia's early advantage is what helped it to more rapidly develop literacy, metallurgy, technology, and empire.